Thank you for joining us both virtually and in person. I am honored to continue to serve as the Idaho State Senator and Minority Leader, and alongside with my colleague, Ilana Rubel, Representative Rubel, who is the Minority Leader in the House. Our caucuses remain committed to championing the best interest of all Idahoans and working to pass smart, thoughtful legislation that provides all our people and in our state's future. The 2021 session officially ended just 11 short weeks ago. Despite it being the longest in state history at 311 days, we accomplished little in the way of addressing some of the many critical issues impacting Idaho and that you asked us to do. We cannot allow unkept promises to happen again in 2022, and we have to set aside political grandstanding and put our working families first. One of the primary areas of focus this session must be infrastructure, especially as our state continues to grow at an unprecedented rate. Idaho has $1.6 billion in state funds on hand, $1.9 billion if you add in the rainy day funds, and $1 billion from the Federal American Rescue Plan Act, which can provide timely investment opportunities for transportation, education, broadband, water and electrical grids, housing, and healthcare. We can also expand even more with the Federal Infrastructure Plan, further enabling us to make critical improvements in a variety of areas. Our state cannot afford to squander this opportunity, and we have to move Idaho forward. Throughout the state, there are numerous roads, bridges, and railway systems aging out and incapable of safely handling the heavier, longer, and faster loads, pressuring their antiquated structures. This is particularly true within our underfunded counties, where an unsafe bridge forces detours for school buses and commercial trucks, seriously impacting local economies. Water and sewer systems are either inadequate or the increased demand has made them so unsafe. They are old and they need to be replaced. Growth has exacerbated the need for safe water and waste treatment facilities. If we make these investments now, we can vastly improve our public safety and boost our economy by creating a number of jobs for our people while saving time and money in the long term. Idaho's per pupil spending continues to be one of the worst in the nation. Public schools struggle to find necessary resources, leading to insufficient teacher pay, no ability to find housing, and increased staff turnover, and also crumbling facilities in both rural and urban areas. Growth only compounds this. Adding more students and curtailing educational services is an already beleaguered education system, harms teachers and students, and does not adequately provide a skilled workforce for commerce, turning away high-wage employees from our state. And this will never change if the legislature continues to gut schools, skirting its constitutional obligation. Last year, $2.5 billion was cut from our higher education institutions, which act as the backbone of our state, fostering the next generation of leaders and boosting our economy. In 2021, 92 of Idaho's 115 school districts ran levies totaling $217 million. What was designed as a fallback system is now used for core maintenance and causes property taxes to increase. Strong and successful communities start with our children's schools. Empowering families with devices and broadband is a start, but school districts and teachers desperately need resources in the classroom too, to ensure facilities are safe and functional and children receive an excellent education no matter where they live. Democrats have been working to install all-day kindergarten and early learning programs for years in our state. A full day of instruction helps boost literacy rates among children and give them a better foundation for success. Last session, a $6 million grant to fund early learning opportunities statewide was rejected. Idaho is one of four states with no public preschool. We had the opportunity to change that. Politics must never prevail over people, and especially not over our children. That's why we also must address our child care crisis. Families shouldn't lose work to be unable to afford living needs because of a lack of child care. We can't have a robust economy if there aren't affordable, high quality, and safe facilities available to watch one's children while at work. Staff at these places need to be paid appropriately as well, helping to attract and retain workers to combat the shortage. The healthcare industry continues to struggle amid the pandemic as well, with too few workers and too little housing. Idaho has at least the least amount of healthcare workers per capita in the nation. A transition to telehealth has given some relief for patients, but in many areas, particularly those that are medically unserved, they also have poor broadband. This is also true for remote learning in our schools. With our population growth and these added loads, our broadband demand is beyond capacity. We must also look to solve our housing shortage. The market has exploded with little remaining inventory and inflated prices. Wages in Idaho are low and not keeping up with this boom. This unaffordability shuts out our hardworking families, our first responders, our workers, our seniors, and our young adults who are the fabric of our communities. The governor mentioned this, his family's many generations living in Idaho and his grandchildren's ability to choose to stay here. All our youth should be able to choose to remain in Idaho and provide an economy where they can afford to do so. Right now, we have the rare opportunity to be creative and strategic about our resources at all levels of government and the private sector. Partnerships and pooling resources can successfully tackle larger projects, and more funding options and autonomy to cities and counties are imperative for local services and programs. Our ailing infrastructure needs cannot continue to be ignored, or they will collapse. And neither can our schools, and Idahoans deserve long-term benefits from their tax investment.
Thank you so much, Senator Stennett. I echo her words and just emphasize what an honor it is to serve across the rotunda from her and to serve with my remarkable caucus mates. As the governor noted, this is a time of great opportunity, but I believe it's also a time of great potential peril if we do not act responsibly. This session could go in one of two directions. We could use the resources we have to finally fix some of the serious problems that threaten our future. As Senator Stennett noted, an underfunded public education system, a housing crisis, a property tax crisis, and more. These problems could largely be fixed this year with the funds that we have available. Or we could get bogged down in divisive social issues and let our real problems fester and worsen while the money we have in our treasury is showered upon the wealthy without any measurable benefit to the working families of Idaho. We have the tools we need this year to set Idaho on a very promising path, and Democrats will be doing all we can to work across the aisle to make that happen. But first, I want to correct the notion of a budget surplus that the governor referenced. This money was generated by systematically underfunding vital services. Now, the governor suggested we look at the state budget much as we would look at a household budget. Now, if you haven't paid your mortgage or your utility bills, you may appear to have a lot of money in your checking account. But you would not call that a true surplus, or you certainly wouldn't call it a sign of responsible management. And that's exactly what's happening here. Idaho has a lot of money in the bank account right now, but it's in large part due to irresponsible decision-making by politicians, where children and working families have been left to pay the price. We remain last in per-pupil education investment in America, as you've heard. We are still one of only four states in America with no early childhood education, and these are not without consequence. They've contributed to alarming deterioration in our education outcomes, where we're seeing real drops in literacy and go-on rates and performance scores and graduation rates. Our lack of affordable childcare is creating a workforce crisis. We have a foster care system on the brink of collapse due to underfunding. We have, as the senator mentioned, I think over 1,500 bridges in need of repair at an estimated cost of over $2 billion. We have a major housing crisis and a completely unfunded Affordable Housing Trust Fund, which, unfortunately, from what I heard in the governor's speech, is to remain unfunded under his proposed budget. We have places all around the state where they can't, 65% of the emergency medical providers around the state say they can't get ambulances out on time because they don't have the money to hire staff and need to rely entirely on volunteers. We have low-income seniors being driven from their homes by rising property taxes because the state chose to take away their property tax relief last session through House Bill 389. Now, we very much appreciate that the governor's proposed budget does include investment in some of these areas, but we are nowhere near out of the woods in terms of addressing the core vital services that government is responsible for providing in this state. And frankly, until we are out of last place in education, This is no time for a victory lap, and it is certainly no time to be planning income tax cuts that we know will overwhelmingly benefit the wealthy and well-connected. To be clear, the Democratic caucus is strongly in favor of tax relief, but not the trickle-down variety that the GOP supermajority delivers every year and are evidently planned again. Last year, we saw a bill that took $400 million out of the general fund that funds education so they could give approximately $10,000 tax cuts to millionaires, while regular working folks largely received closer to $50 to $100. And our GOP colleagues did this while cutting the education budget, as the senator mentioned, and leaving teachers so underpaid that 20% of Idaho teachers polled are strongly considering leaving the profession. This is precisely the opposite of what should be happening, and yet we're disturbed to hear that they're planning to do the very same thing again. Decades of data have shown everywhere and unequivocally that trickle-down economics does not work. Never has, never will. Yet, inexplicably, it remains the go-to strategy for Idaho's GOP supermajority. This legislature has been a one-trick pony for years. Every time we have any money in the bank, GOP legislators rush to pass a bill to give that money away in income tax cuts to the wealthiest individuals and corporations, sometimes not even in the state, sometimes out-of-state corporations. And we are so disappointed that this is, again, the governor's and the GOP legislators' intention. Now, when it comes to tax relief, we think we should be laser-focused on reducing property taxes for the people of Idaho, not cutting income taxes for those at the top. And we should be doing it in a way that protects and improves vital government services like public education, infrastructure, and law enforcement. We have listened to our constituents. They desperately want a break from skyrocketing property taxes. I have never been contacted by a constituent clamoring for more income tax breaks for those at the top. This is something that only GOP legislators seem to be seeking. It is not something we are seeing that is desired by people on the street. But it was the legislature that caused our current property tax crisis, and they have the power and the responsibility to fix it. And Idaho Democrats have a robust slate of property tax legislation, which comprise responsible, effective solutions that are designed to protect and improve the services our citizens expect. We hope that these bills will not again be blocked from receiving hearings or votes, as unfortunately has happened for the past 3 years. And we hope that the public will speak up and encourage committee chairs to allow us to have hearings and votes on these bills. But I wanted to provide a brief overview of what this Democratic slate of property tax solutions includes. First, treating internet sales tax the same as in-store sales tax. So simple, most people don't even realize the current system. Very few people realize that the sales tax they pay on an internet sales purchase does not in any way fund community needs like fire or police or schools, whereas the sales tax they pay on a shirt in a store actually does fund those things. I have yet to meet anybody, whether they're a Republican, a Democrat, a Libertarian, or a Bull Moose Party adherent, who thinks this is a good idea. But it's an incredibly simple fix. If we simply had equal treatment of sales tax across the board, this would have yielded enormous property tax relief. First of all, it would have been a straight pass-through of $36 million in terms of funding to local government services. That's $36 million dropping to the bottom line, reducing people's property taxes. In addition, it would have put another $275 million into the general fund, which would have been more than enough to cover our entire $217 million school levy bill. So that would be massive property tax relief with the simplest tweak to our statutes. Back of the envelope estimate is that this would reduce maybe 30 to 40% of people's property taxes with just simply equal treatment of internet sales tax. This is something we very much want to see and we'll be pushing to see happen. And as more sales shift online, this problem is only going to get exacerbated and the loss to our schools and our local services is only going to get worse. Second, a meaningful increase in the property tax relief for low-income seniors, veterans, and those with disabilities. And we need to reverse the effects of House Bill 389, which kicked over 4,000 low-income seniors off of their property tax relief program. Very simple fix that we are going to be pushing to see happen, and we certainly have the money to do it. Third, restoring the indexed homeowners exemption. While there was a small increase last session, it increased it to 125,000. We know that if the indexed exemption were still in place, it would be a $175,000 exemption, which again would provide for very meaningful property tax relief for homeowners. Fourth, allowing impact fees on new development to pay for new school construction so that growth pays for growth and longstanding property owners don't have to foot the bill for that growth, as is currently happening. And fifth, capping assessment increases so that homeowners don't see shocking increases in their property tax bill because of shifts in their local housing market that are outside of their control. These are genuine solutions that look at the real root of the cause of the problem of our property tax crisis while preserving and, in most cases, enhancing vital services. And again, we hope that the public will help us push these ideas forward so we're not once again denied an ability to get hearings. And truly, for the life of me, I cannot understand why instead of doing these things, we would instead pass a tax cut for the rich when we can't pay ambulance personnel to come when a person is having a heart attack. I was quite shocked at the recent OPE report showing the breadth of our state that is relying entirely on volunteer services. I have to say personally, I was the victim of a third-degree burn a few years ago, and it was excruciating, and I'm very thankful that I lived in a place where we do have paid ambulance personnel, and they were at my house in about 10 minutes, because every one of those minutes I was waiting felt like a lifetime, and I can't even imagine sitting there with that kind of injury for an hour and a half, because the state has declined to provide funding for actual personnel to show up in an emergency. Democrats plan to run a bill to address this problem. We also have legislation to give financial help to educators willing to teach in rural and underserved areas, to provide for a full-day kindergarten option, to actually fund the Affordable Housing Trust Fund, to allocate one-time facilities funding to school districts that they can, if they choose, use to pay down school bonds, again, alleviating property taxes. We have legislation to eliminate the grocery tax, to seal records for individuals who have committed minor criminal offenses, to allow medical cannabis to alleviate the suffering Idahoans who are now forced into opioid use for their pain, and improving processes for sexual assault survivors, and numerous other bills. There is much opportunity to work across the aisle this session to devise bipartisan solutions and do some real good for the people of Idaho. And we are ready to make that happen in 2022. We hope our colleagues across the aisle are as well. Again, thank you all for coming and listening, and happy to answer any of your questions.
Governor Little's state of the state did not address much of the housing crisis that you mentioned. What would you like to see done this year, whether it be the Housing Trust Fund or you tell me, what are some steps we can take?
The lowest hanging fruit is really the Affordable Housing Trust Fund, because that has been created, there's a plan in place, it's just completely unfunded. But that would be really simple, to put funding in that fund. It's ready to go, it just doesn't have any money in it. We have the money, let's put it in that fund and start, you know, directly addressing our affordable housing crisis. I think to some extent property taxes do play into affordable housing, because many people are actually being driven out of their homes and are finding their homes unaffordable due to the property tax situation. But those are the two things that I am aware of that we have legislation prepared to address. Senator Stennett, do you have anything you'd want to add to that?
There are a few ideas out there. We're trying to talk to the Tax Commission and to Legislative Services to talk about statute, but there is thought that perhaps if somebody were given incentive on their income taxes rather than on the rental money that they make for like landlords, if the incentive was enough, then you could possibly get more people who would leave it in the rental market instead of putting it into an Airbnb kind of situation. There is creative ways that there are public private partnerships. I know in my area we've had a housing problem for a long, long time, and it is particularly exacerbated with no inventory and the cost of it getting a home. And so that has really compromised our workforce, our first responders, healthcare providers. We have teachers living in trailers out in the public lands. We have first responders who perhaps lived in Ketchum, but couldn't find housing, had to go to Bellevue, they're not a first responder at that point. You know, so these are the basic services that Representative Rebell was talking about that we do need to try to create. So because of an absence of our ability to seem to help from government level, and because we took that power away from local governments in the bill in 2017, I think it was, that says the state has to make those decisions and not local governments, and everybody knows that every local jurisdiction has little differing needs, so it should be placed back. So there are two things happening. One, that we should probably repeal or make an amendment to that bill to allow more autonomy at the local level. But the other side is creating partnerships where your hospitals and your school districts and larger health providers or those where it's possible for them to work with people within the community who have the power to invest in them, so they create dedicated housing for those workers. And we have to be thinking about everything possible we can to make sure that we move that along. I mean, at some point they keep telling us there's going to be a market correction. But in the meantime, do we know when that is? And do we know how that will? And it usually lags, housing usually lags behind other indicators about inflation will lag into the housing and all the things we're seeing now. So what can we do proactively at every level we can to make sure that those kinds of opportunities happen at all levels of government?
If I may, a quick follow-up to that. The governor had been expected to announce he was going to put some $40 million or so into the Housing Trust Fund. He did not. Instead, his administration announced today that he's going to put $50 million of ARPA funds into a new program for workforce housing through IHFA, which will be targeted at gap financing, exactly the thing he had been talking about for the Affordable Housing Trust Fund. What do you think of that approach with that $50 million in federal funds?
He was pretty lean on the details about that. How would he be allocated? The problem with a lot of those programs, I'm happy to hear about workforce housing because you can differentiate between affordable and workforce because amount of government insertion in it. Like true affordable housing programs require a lot of hoops to jump through on a federal and state level. They oftentimes you have to sort of be put on a wait list, you have to prove the need, this sort of thing. Workforce housing in the various types of things I was just mentioning can be a little more flexible than that. So my question is to the money he's putting in that, how rigorous does it for that person, how many things does that person have to do to before they win the lottery to get? Is it something where that they help get some kind of subsidized mortgage? Is it that they help a little bit but you're still responsible for the greater majority? I just don't know what his program plans on doing. And really $50 million is not a lot when you're looking at a housing problem all across the state. You know how expensive housing is at this point. And so it's a start. Anything we put towards it is a start. But his speech was very lean on details. So we're still waiting to find out what the details are.
And following up on that, I would certainly want to know more about what the difference is in the categories of people who would qualify. Would you be beholden to a particular employer to be able to access the workforce housing? Which I think would be concerning. Is there some body of people who need housing that would qualify under the Housing Trust Fund traditionally that might not qualify under this affordable housing plan that he discussed? I think there's a lot that needs to be fleshed out in terms of what this looks like.
Did we have a question right there?
Yeah.
That was sort of my question, but another one related to that. There was a few proposals that are being put forward by Senator Wintrow, it sounds like, of affordable housing, some code changes. What about the one that's kind of allowing affordable housing developments to be managed by somebody other than who owns those homes?
I'm not familiar with the details of her proposal, but I will tell her to get in touch with you directly, because I'm sure she has a magnificently well-researched, well-thought-out solution that she should have the opportunity to present herself.
She obviously hasn't told us the two of us the details, so we will find out.
What do your caucuses think of the various investments that the governor laid out? Based on your remarks, it sounds like it's not enough, but what do you think of the priorities that were laid out today?
I was certainly pleased at some of the priorities you laid out today. I was glad to hear there was an increase in the education funding proposed. Again, in terms of magnitude, I'd be curious to see when everything plays out if this will actually be enough to take us out of last place in America. I think we need something well in excess of what he proposed, and personally, I would love to see us get to at least 40th place in America. You know, that would be a start. We're in a swamp, and this might be one step more towards the edge of the swamp, but it's not going to get us out of the swamp. And that's really what we would have liked to see, is get to a real level where we're not facing a teacher recruitment and retention crisis, where we're seeing genuine improvement in literacy and completion rates, all of that. I was very happy to hear about the investment in behavioral health. I need to get some more details, because one of the things I really wanted to hear, as I said, very concerned about our foster care system. We need to see increased reimbursement rates for parents participating in the program. We very much need to see increased reimbursement rates for mental health care providers and social workers in the program. And again, big big empty space on housing. But overall, I was happy to hear that there's, you know, some meaningful investment going into these areas.
I was taking notes as fast as I could about what it was that he was actually going to spend money on, and the majority of it was about a tax break and a tax cut. And the interesting thing is we keep being told that these are one-time monies. And when you think about, well, $1.9 billion with what it is at surplus, and another billion with ARPA, and I'm not sure, maybe another billion with infrastructure, you know, it looks like that a tax cut, but he was saying that was sustained over another billion over the next 5 years. Well, if you keep telling us that it's one-time monies, but then you're planning on giving all this money back over a five-year period when you don't even know what your economy is, it just seems to be not logical. And we all know from years of talking to economists that your best bang for your buck over the long term, and it'll look long term, is to put it into your infrastructure. It benefits the most Idahoans more than giving them a little bit of a rebate back in their checks. And so he really was long on what he would give back in these lump tax breaks or cuts, but pretty not a lot of detail on. I mean, if you're talking about $200 million for bridges for locals, a bridge is expensive. I mean, that's just not, it's mm-hmm. not really going to meet the muster. If you talk about $200 million cutting back the one-third backlog of insufficient or deficient bridges, I'm unfortunately the queen of the most least well-paved and most timed out bridges in the state, and I can tell you that it's the community suffers when they're not, and it's unsafe. And so I think that we really just didn't hear a lot of substance about what would do those sorts of things that would help all Idahoans who have to travel and use the services and this sort of thing. And so we're hoping more is in there. We keep saying that we really appreciate the good things that he has said in prior speeches about what it is that he proposes to do that we've been talking about the Democrats for a long, long time. And then by the time we get to the end of session, we see virtually nothing because it has been somehow diminished in the amount or goes away or doesn't pass legislative muster or it gets negotiated where it doesn't exist anymore, and then we have something that's rapid and fire drill in the last week that is poorly crafted and doesn't really meet the needs and say yep we did that and then go home. And I think we're really tired of seeing that. This is a really truly good opportunity to do really meaningful things that will help over the next few decades, and we're just going to keep yelling from the rafters about it and hopefully get something done.
And if we are going to be committing to long-term revenue loss through these tax cuts, as appears to be the plan, it's immensely frustrating that the only thing they're willing to look at is these income tax cuts that are targeted to the wealthy. There are so many ways you could cut taxes. You could cut property taxes, you could cut grocery taxes, you could cut sales taxes, you could cut all kinds of taxes that would actually benefit real working families. And it's infuriating that we have these blinders on, that the only tax cuts they're willing to look at are the ones that land all the money on millionaires.
I don't know if you saw that they had a group of people on Friday morning that were think tanks about taxes, the tax structure, and according to them, they said that we're about 17th in the nation on that. We're a three-pronged tax, so we have the income tax, the property tax, and the sales tax, which puts us at a pretty good standing considering that the other ones we were competing against don't have all the tax structure that we do. But they were second in the most prohibitive property tax structure, second only to Utah, which is the second state that's growing as fast as we are, and that was a real place, they said, where you could do something meaningful for the people in deferring taxes for your elderly, your property tax for elderly, and doing all the things that Representative Revelle had mentioned. They had some really thoughtful things that were working really well in other states, and we should be really seriously entertaining those if we want to do something that the Idahoans have asked us to do for several years now.
Any other questions out there? Oh, Kevin.
I was curious, you brought up the grocery tax. Conservatives, when they did their news conference this morning, talked about the grocery tax prominently. Is that an area you see your caucus working with conservative Republicans on?
Yeah, I mean, very, very frankly, I've gone back and forth on this issue because I've had some concerns that if you eliminate the grocery tax credit, that it actually hurts poorer families. If you eliminate both the grocery tax and the grocery tax credit, currently those in the lower echelons of income actually get more back in the credit than they pay in the grocery tax. So the current structure is potentially beneficial to those who are very low income. But I think there's a proposal out there that would leave that credit in place while eliminating the grocery tax. I have concerns about eliminating revenue period when we have the lowest funded schools in America and all these other problems. However, if we're going to go down that path, if we're going to be eliminating vast amounts of revenue for the state without meeting our educational objectives, I would certainly rather see that land in the pockets of working families. And I think eliminating the grocery tax credit while keeping the credit, the tax while keeping the credit, would achieve that goal vastly, vastly better than these income tax cuts that they're talking about. And so I think it would by far be the better course if we're going to be exploring revenue reduction. Let's at least do it in a way that helps the people who need it. And I think cutting the grocery tax comes a whole lot closer to doing that than any of these income tax proposals.
So there are two schools of thought. Sorry.
Whose bill is it that does that eliminates the grocery tax and keeps the credit? Is that your bill or is that?
We have a bill that would do that. I think actually there might be one coming from the Liberty Caucus that does that as well. So we may be fusing efforts on that.
No worries. Now, there are two schools of thought, as you probably know, that a lot of people feel like taking the grocery tax away. We have a lot of tourism. We have a lot of people traveling through, mm-hmm. a lot of second homeowners, and they pay into that resource that helps all of us because we still have to pay for their emergency services and everything else while they're here, and so they should be contributing to the system. So there's a school of thought that you keep that in place and then you just give more targeted grocery tax relief to those that are of an economic level, and it would be some kind of scale as to how much you would get back, and that would be more strategic and targeted. And others that believe that a full-on, because it's so regressive, that grocery taxes are just regressive to the greater population, especially as the food, our food isn't inflationarily going up so fast that gas and food is what people notice the most. And so somehow giving them relief with just a straightforward grocery tax elimination would be a timely thing to do. So either of those, I think, would give the people who are most impacted by the cost of groceries some kind of relief, and we should do any or all or a portion of any of that. So.
Pretty big increase in social workers in the governor's proposed budget. But I've heard from a lot of people who want more reforms in terms of training and support and all of that foster families. Do you have any legislation to make for that?
We've been looking at legislation again that would enhance the compensation rate, because right now I think there's a real crisis with the reimbursement rate. That is, you know, making it impossible to get the number of skilled caregivers that are needed for the system. So that's what we're looking at right now. I think the details of how they're trained is probably something that could be administered within the department. But if there is legislation that makes sense to improve that, I think it is a multi-pronged disaster right now that really needs tackling on a lot of fronts. I'm sure that training is required, just numbers of people is required, amount those people are being paid is required, again, amount of compensation to the parents participating in the foster care system. The system has really been left to dilapidate and is in great disrepair right now, and it is likely to be more than a single fix required.
And this has become exacerbated with COVID, because I have friends in social workers, and they said that their load has doubled, and they're trying to do it through a telehealth system, which isn't as interpersonal as doing it in person, and then they're not able to see them for like once every 3 months or whatever, which is really not a healthcare or a crisis care kind of management. It's just never gonna meet any kind of threshold of help for those folks. And the increase of the amount of more demand because of all of the mental health constraints that are happening at all levels, whether it's your healthcare providers, your school systems, your general population, it is in really real crisis, and we pay so little, and this is just a continuous problem. We have the least amount of wages per capita in the nation. I mean, the highest amount of minimum wage earners in the nation. And if you look at all the people who work at this building, you can ask any of one of our great people who work here, they're like getting $17 an hour, you get 15 at McDonald's. I mean, if you're really trying to get people to come to the workforce, you have to pay for it, especially with the way the inflation and the housing and cost of living is. And you can't keep expecting that we keep training in our agencies and departments and our schools and all of these other workforce areas, and then we train them and they go to our bordering states for more benefits and more wages. That's just fiscally irresponsible. And it's not sustainable. So, I mean, we're putting more and more pressures even within our own agency and departments in the government, and it is undermanned, it's underpaid, and so we're expecting to do better work with just a skeleton crew, to speak to what Representative Rebell said. We cannot continue to be so austere, we cease to function. And so there are a lot of places, and particularly as it pertains to any kind of crisis care, whether it's our children in foster care or our healthcare workers or, you know, social workers or the poor people that are in our assisted living homes. I mean, they're getting, I think, $6,000 for a patient that from Medicare that costs $12,000 to house them. I mean, this, you can't continue to function this way. It is just not going to last. And it gives poor service, not because they don't want to do their best work, it's because they're incapable of doing it. They just don't have the resources.
Kevin.
The governor didn't talk much about it. He's proposed a 7.1% increase for higher education. Given what you saw last session, do you think that's adequate? And do you think that's
I'd be happy to see that actually flies by the end of session.
I would be delighted to see that pass. You know, there is a war on higher education going on right now. The Freedom Foundation has, you know, pulled the veil away and exposed that they are genuinely opposed to any kind of public education at any level, and they don't think we should have public universities. Last year we not only saw an inadequate increase, we saw a decrease. So a 7.1% increase is needed, and I would be very grateful to get it in this political climate. I don't know if it's adequate, but you know, we live in the world of the possible, and that's, I hope, possible.
We hear from your caucus, as well as from the Liberty Caucus frequently, frustrations that you have bills ready for these different proposals and they don't make it anywhere, whether it's in going across the rotunda or ending up in a chairman's desk drawer somewhere. Is your party still confident in this legislative process and the amount of power that the committee chairmans wield over what legislation moves forward?
Do we have confidence that they have that kind of power? We've seen that they have that kind of power. But you mean that they will change that power? Do you have any confidence?
I am not happy with the current system. And that's, you know, I have a lot of bills that have been filling up committee chairman's drawers over the years. Notably, you know, years I passed, you know, reforming mandatory minimum sentencing legislation, for example, for drug offenders, and passed through the House, I think, three times with a supermajority, only to be ever denied the light of day on the Senate side. We've seen, again, all of our tax bills have been buried while, you know, citizens are suffering with crazy property taxes and we can't get 1 minute of committee time or a vote on anything. I am immensely frustrated with the system. And a few years ago, I actually brought a rule change saying that any, the ultimate irony, it was a rule change saying that any piece of legislation that has at least 5 co-sponsors from each party would be guaranteed a hearing and a vote. And of course, that bill didn't get a hearing or a vote, so yes, irony reigns supreme. But I think it's problematic. I think we should have a system like that, where at least if there's something that has some kind of broad-based support, I think Representative Skog had a bill that had perhaps the majority of the House, it had in excess of 30 co-sponsors on it to restore the indexed homeowners exemption. Couldn't get a bill heard in committee. So it's not necessarily just the problem that Democrats have. I would like to see a more open environment in which more ideas can be heard and the public has more of a chance to weigh in.
It's a little easier to get things printed in the Senate, but beyond that, there's still things sitting in drawers. Yes.
Are you reaching a point of frustration? To this point, you guys have tried to be the adults in the room and vote for good stuff and you know, let the chips fall where they may. But as we saw last last session, you could have used your power to get appropriation bills through. You could have, if you had been willing to let those bills die, you could have played hardball.
Well,
you get to the point where you're considering.
Well, you just, I mean, I have to speak to a lot of the power, who has the power bills in the last session, whether it's the governor or the legislature, landed with the seven of us in the Senate to be able to make sure the governor was able to maintain some kind of control over what his office does as opposed to giving more power to the legislature. We had long discussions about whether we wanted to play hardball, but at the same time, I want to be the adult in the room, and I want to make sure that we're setting a real integrity, honest, straightforward, respectful, civil, and thoughtful process. I'm not sure I want to devolve into the scrappy fighting unless there's something super meaningful that we can make that I can make a real difference in. And there was a couple of things that we tried to work really hard on that we could barter with, and we were not able to make that happen. But it isn't for lack of effort. We don't do it out on the floor all the time. We do it quietly with our colleagues and with all the levels of branches of government and negotiate, and we get a lot of things done quietly. But I see your point. Is there something you'd recommend that would be a suggestion?
I mean, getting to your point on the House side, because I think that some of that really comes into play more on the House side. I guess my fear is that we're in a very different legislature right now than the one I entered 9 years ago. When I came here 9 years ago, appropriation bills were the most boring bills of the session. They came up, they would be up and down in 1.5 minutes. Everybody knew that JFAC had put a lot of time and energy into vetting everything, and it was all carefully thought through, and they would pass, 68-2 or something. Now it is anybody's guess when these bills hit the floor as to whether we will even have an attorney general next year, or whether we will even have a Department of Health and Welfare. And I guess my fear, well, we could try to flex our muscle, because you're right, there were many critical appropriations last session that the majority of House Republicans voted against, and that only passed because every Democrat voted in favor. Things like the entire Medicaid budget, not just Medicaid expansion, but all of Medicaid,
public television.
The Hispanic Commission, the Department of Parks and Recreation, the Council on Developmental Disabilities, the Council on Domestic Violence. I mean, major agencies, major services of government that the majority of our GOP colleagues voted to shut down and completely defund. And so we could do an experiment and throw our votes in and kill these things, but I guess my fear is I think this current legislature might actually shoot the hostage. And I think there's a not insubstantial chance that if we did that, we would actually emerge with no Medicaid or with no Department of Parks and Recreation. I'm not sure that they would respond by saying, oh, okay, Democrats, we'll be more reasonable and give you hearings on your bills. I think we might just descend further into absolute dysfunction. And so I guess that's a risk that we've been reluctant to take, because we do fundamentally value the people of Idaho and the services that we that we feel we're obligated to provide. Oh, yeah.
Hey, so the governor proposed allocating $47 million to early literacy, and you did that rather than specifically saying that all districts should have full-day kindergarten, right? But gave them the option to do so with that money. I'm curious about your conference's thoughts on that decision. Should the money be that flexible and local controlled, or should the state take a stronger hand in guiding that money?
I personally would have preferred to see, I wouldn't mind both. I think they serve different functions. I think it would be reasonable to allocate more money into literacy programs, although that can take other forms than full-day kindergarten. That might involve some sort of early childhood or, over the summer programs. But I think there is something separate and discrete about full-day kindergarten that should have been in there. And I'm going to push for it. We're all going to push for it. Because I think we're still going to have some of the lingering problems we have now if we don't have that offered as an option throughout the state. We're still going to have potentially areas that means tested, or that don't offer it at all, or that still end up having to rely on levies. I think it's something that just should be put out there. Frankly, I'm surprised the governor doesn't want to do that, because that it's a lost opportunity for him. That could be a real legacy item. People look back at the glory days of Cecil Andrus and say he brought us kindergarten. And Governor Little could be in a position to say, I was the guy in the governor's office when we finally brought full-day kindergarten to Idaho. I don't think anybody is going to say, oh, I'm, you know, like, wow, you're the guy who marginally increased literacy funds. I don't think it has the same kind of punch as a legacy item. So I'm surprised that he didn't want to go down that path. But for my own legacy, I would like to be the legislator that was in here pushing to get the people of Idaho an option for full day kindergarten. And I think it would provide unique value beyond just throwing a few more dollars into nebulous literacy programs.
He did mention that he was also putting money into Head Start, which mm-hmm. is an early learning program, obviously. But some people say, because some of the school districts have been doing this for a while and they've already got their structures in place, and so not every school district who already has kindergarten will need to set up. And so they should be able to be allowed the option of using those resources for something that enhances their early learning, and the others that don't use it for that purpose. Yeah. But it would have been nice if the language was more straightforward.
But that said, I'm extremely happy about money into a Head Start. I've had many meetings with their staff pushing for funding of Head Start for going back a couple of years. I think it is stark raving madness that the state has not been funding Head Start. There was a wait list, last I checked, of 2,000 kids and more trying to get into the Head Start program. These are the most at-risk kids in the state. These are the kids whose parents have drug problems, whose parents are incarcerated. I mean, these are the kids who are, you know, very, very, very likely to end up in our correction system, not graduating from high school, having real problems if they don't get help early on. And to leave thousands of those kids hanging in the wind, not able to get into the program, just seems incredibly, you know, penny-wise and pound foolish, as they say. So I'm very happy. I think that should have been a top priority for the state for years. Anyone? Kevin?
Just one last quick question. I'm curious how the tone of the speech hit you both. I mean, there were several mentions of president
yes.
border security, inflation, vaccine mandates.
We were surprised about the political language that we've not seen before in his speech, understanding that it is a primary and election year. And then when he did mention about borders, we're like, and then he did finally come back with one of them, but we're like, well, we've got some of the worst drug trafficking and human trafficking going across our state. Why don't we pay attention to our borders? You know, talk about Idaho borders instead of our southern borders, to pay attention to state borders and work on those programs. He did mention that he planned on putting in some law enforcement to enhance the drug problems that are traveling through our state. But we were pretty surprised by how lean the content of what his budget would look like and what he chose to say instead.
I mean, I guess it's what one might expect in a, when, you know, given that he will be facing a primary, and I guess, you know, he felt, you have to ask him, I guess he felt he had to throw some red meat out there and just, you know, have every other sentence be Biden bashing. Although I think there's a little bit of doublespeak in there, and that he's also, you know, bragging about finally working through our infrastructure backlog, which would not be happening without the infrastructure bill passed by the president. And so certainly there seems to be a great happiness to accept those benefits that President Biden delivers, while I guess trying to conversely get whatever political benefit there is from every other sentence be Biden bashing. It was a little disappointing. I think it's important that we be working well with all branches of government, and just slinging wild insults to the chief executive of the country, you know, probably isn't going to get us a lot of goodwill and to the on the federal side, but it is what it is, and GOP closed primaries are what they are, and I guess that's what we will get until they open their primaries. Anyone else?
Thank you very much for
Thank
all
you
your
all
great
so
questions.
Much.
Appreciate
Thank
your time with us.